Welcome to Literary Hangover Episode 1, The Spy by James Fenimore Cooper. I'm your host, Matt Leck. Thank you very much for being here. You may know me as producer on The Majority Report, The Michael Brooks Show, The Tarfu Report, Antifada for a little bit. In a few minutes, I'll be joined by Alex Guns. He'll be my co-pilot for a number of these episodes. But first, I wanted to thank you for being here, number one. It means a lot to me that you're here at the launch of my podcast. I genuinely thank everybody interested. This is going to be a podcast about fiction, novels generally, and the social, economic, historical, political forces that sort of influence the authors or authorship, and also are represented in those books. But we talk more about that later. Why The Spy is the first one is for a couple of reasons. It's the first sort of big novel by James Fenimore Cooper, who is sort of the grandfather mythologist of young America, basically. He's right there at the beginning. The Spy is 1821. There aren't terribly many notable books prior to that. In fact, as J. Gerald Kennedy of Strange Nation, he writes, Cooper's The Spy, the first novel produced to meet a demand for distinctively American literature, seems in retrospect a bizarre evocation of the new nation and its fight for independence. The author's principal setting, the rural neutral ground of New York's Westchester County, proves not a hotbed of rebellion, but rather a zone of uncertainty and violence, where military control is as problematic as the political sympathies of local residents. We're going to start with sort of American fiction, and I felt like this is being sort of the first one. In fact, Fenimore Cooper's sister wrote a bunch of introductions to his novels years after this, and here's what she writes about it. On the 17th of September, 1821, The Spy, A Tale of the Neutral Ground, was published. The book immediately attracted general attention, probably beyond what any American volume had yet done. It was read with delight. The strikingly original character of Harvey Birch, so clearly conceived, so thoroughly blah, blah, blah. But it made a big impact to the point where Harvey Birch, the spy, the titular spy, people tried to speculate who he, in fact, was historically. And in fact, this was sort of the first spy novel, according to Bruce A. Rosenberg in the American Transcendental Quarterly in 1993. He writes, Cooper also gave us the first spy novel, a genre whose time has finally come round at last. Many spy novelists, Eric Amber, Graham Greene, and John le Carré, for instance, credit John Buchan, I don't know how to pronounce that, as being their creative inspiration. Probably they too had never read an American book, certainly not Cooper's. So many of Cooper's insights and many of those quite remarkable had to be rediscovered. This podcast is meant to be listenable to people who have and have not read the books, and I'm hoping that maybe as sort of primers for the books. Let me know how that actually works, especially for those who don't intend to read the books, if we need to prioritize more nonfiction context and that sort of thing. But we include plenty of audio from the actual books and from secondary sources, so hopefully there's enough to keep everybody involved. But I am interested in feedback on this, and you can send that to theliteraryhangover@gmail.com. That's theliteraryhangover@gmail.com. I don't usually use the, but anyway, there it is. Anyway, I plan to release on the first and third Saturdays of each month. So, but there will be I think we're going to release an episode recorded in 2016 about 1984 for subscribing members next week. We'll get right to it. We start kind of casually, so casually I have to bleep somebody's name out immediately so I don't get them in academic trouble for letting me borrow some JSTOR passwords. But anyway, enjoy the show. I got my academic search password.
Oh, nice.
And so I've been just downloading shit like crazy.
I did a scrub of the academic articles around The Spy. Shitload.
Oh, yeah.
There's like a ton of them.
Yes.
Like The Spy as the Wandering Jew. The Spy as really in like a intense dialogue with the literary tradition, like European literary tradition that I wasn't expecting.
Yeah, I was on Oneida. I don't know how to pronounce that.
I can't remember.
This website, oneonta.edu, has a James Fenimore Cooper Society. And it has, yeah, I pulled like a whole, it has a whole page of literature, academic literature on Fenimore Cooper. Way better than, there's not a similar page for Hawthorne. There is one for Sedgwick, although it doesn't have links to the full articles. It just has like the citations, which is useful if you have access to JSTOR or something. But
yeah,
I used a whole bunch of these. It was really useful, and I'm actually more prone to do more Cooper because of that. I was thinking maybe The Pioneers and Last of the Mohicans.
Yeah, I've read Last of the Mohicans.
Oh, you have?
That's the one that I know him for.
Right, that's the most famous one, definitely.
But I don't know if that's just because of the movie, which also rules.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I think it's really good.
I haven't seen it.
I saw it at Boy Scout camp.
Oh, yeah, isn't Avatar Last of the Mohicans, too?
Yeah, that whole thing of, like, whatever that trope is of the person who the colonizer who, like, joins the group he's trying to colonize, like Last Samurai.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's almost like a pressure release valve for, like, explaining colonialism to be like, well, we weren't all bad.
Right.
Only certain kinds of white people, rather than being like a systemic problem.
That's a big thing with Fenimore Cooper, with not Harvey Birch. Harvey Birch is sort of the prototype for Leatherstocking slash Natty Bumppo.
Mm-hmm. I mean, my immediate takeaway is just the amount of time and energy taken to express like the lack of clarity is something that you don't see when reading Revolutionary War novels or any piece of fiction of the Revolutionary War. It's usually quite clear. And this entire novel is like, actually, we're going to talk about a clandestine part where nothing is clear.
Yeah, in a way that I think sort of is conveniently apolitical.
It's confusing, or it was hard to wrestle my head around exactly what it was going for. Doesn't sound like the right term, but what the aim of this work is, because it's interesting to think of George Washington in like disguise, and like he has to use these clandestine means to do the right thing. That would make sense for someone who's like an insurgent military force. But then the idea that you can recognize Washington by his aura like really undercuts that whole message.
Yeah, I love that. And that seems like such a 19th century fiction sort of like giveaway.
Oh, yeah.
Like it's this person's character is impossible to really, it's going to shine through even disguises, which disguises are way too good too. Like how much do we want to give away with regards to Harper? Did I spoil that for you?
No, I finished it. Wait, what do you mean?
No, so like who Harper is.
Oh, right. I don't know. Like it's, for me reading it, because I don't read spy literature. I don't care for most mysteries. Like, and especially when there's this constant sense of like changing identities, I was kind of like, yeah, okay. Like I feel like a lot of it kind of like went either over my head or not over my head, just went right past me. I was like, yeah, okay, cool.
So you didn't care that it ended up being Harper. This is just going to be a spoiler. This show is not going to be very sensitive to spoilers, by the way.
Yeah, I think if it's in the public domain, it's free from spoilers.
Yeah, I think that's a good, like, we're going to discuss the books. If you can read them beforehand, or you can just not care about spoilers like I do.
And like
just
an adult.
Enjoy the discussion of the book, and then maybe you'll go back and read it. Maybe you don't. I don't know if we're going to, we can save our, whether we recommend people to actually read this to the end, but.
Yeah.
So that's your history with Fenimore Cooper. You read Last of the Mohicans.
Yeah, I read Last Mohicans in middle school.
Okay.
For some reason, not sure why.
Do you have much of a recollection of it?
No, just a super vague one. Like me being, that's like a child's enjoyment of literature, just being like wanting to be there, not wanting to be in the suburbs, like wanting to be in the woods killing things.
Oh, really? So you felt like you wanted to be like an outdoorsman because of this?
Yeah, like that. Or like fantasizing, like, yeah, if I was there, I would do the same thing at like, you know, 9.
Interesting.
And then I think I saw the movie In Boy Scouts, which is like a living out that fantasy of being an outdoorsman. So like, yeah, that's us.
Yeah. Did the outdoorsman thing appeal to you as a kid?
As a kid, yeah. But I only thought this because I feel like most kids who join Boy Scouts, it's because you missed the boat on like fitting in elementary school.
Mm.
So you're like, That was my, I don't know, I should slander other people. That was definitely my thing, is I just could not nail it because I wasn't good at sports and I wasn't particularly adjusted, I feel like. Okay. So I just joined the Cubs.
This is what I always felt about Boy Scouts.
Yeah. I mean, we can ask Aaron. I have a feeling he would say the same about elementary school.
Yeah, interesting. See, I didn't like Boy Scouts because I was into sports. And my dad was a huge, it was like, it was Eagle Scout, the final one.
Yeah.
And he really, he wanted me, he didn't really force me to. When I wanted out, I got out. But I wouldn't have felt that I want to be in the country and being this sort of expert marksman. And because my dad was an outdoorsman and mm-hmm. would always take me to do stuff to the point of exhaustion with it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm tired of, you know, getting up really early in the morning to turkey hunting. Like, it's really cold out. I'd rather be inside playing video games with my friends. Like, all my friends are playing Madden this weekend. I'm going to go, you know, hunt pheasants and walk for miles and miles through brush. Like,
yeah, I imagine it's different if it's your dad or if it's like not a peer, because the whole thing is like, that was cool about it was that it was like a reward situation where it's like, yeah, you carved this thing correctly better than anyone else.
Yeah.
Which I was not better at anything than like more than anyone in school.
I appreciate it much more now. I am trying to get my dad to take me and my brother up to the Hudson Bay. Nice. To go camping, but I don't know if it's going to work.
But anyways, yeah, so Cooper was there, I guess, always as like my childhood fantasies of being in the wilderness and being in war, which I imagine you had the same ones.
Yeah, yeah. And so when you met the spy, what was your sort of feeling about the spy?
Well, at this point, like I had left, whenever I'm reading, not for school, but like for pleasure, it's almost always plotless or very minimal plot. And it's more about prose stylings and different things like that. But like even like I was right before this, I tried reading Name of the Rose.
Oh,
which
yeah.
I love like the dialogues between them. But then like the murder mystery, I was like, I just can't be bothered
to really care that much.
Yeah, it's like another monk died. And it's like, I know another monk died.
Yeah.
So having to read something that's like almost exclusively plot driven, like The Spy, like it really matters the physical surroundings that they're in and like and who's on what side was definitely an exercise in close reading without it being easy because it's like naturally enjoyable.
Yeah, I found that kind of back and forth, like who's captured now, whose authority do they need to? A lot of this book is basically, which important man do they need to appeal to sort this all out? And escaping that, like, let's throw on a disguise and get the fuck out of there.
Yeah, yeah, there's definitely that. And there's, like, also kind of the, it's almost like a comedy of manners that's, like, not funny. Where it's about, like, that would be very inappropriate if this person did this.
The domestic dialogue is awful.
It drives me fucking nuts.
It's terrible, yeah.
And it's like, well, this like wife of mine, she's a truth teller, but it's a good thing that she can't do anything about it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. We'll get to that. But I want to go to that. You mentioned being able to tell Harper was Washington. Spoiler alert.
Right.
For like so obviously because of the certain qualities that are able to be detected through like a glance.
Well, he can sit upright. He has like this glow.
Which is true about George Washington. He did have a stupid lead. Like he was like the Jordan Peterson of his time. when it comes to
positive. He was born in the wrong time.
The book opens with Harper, horseback, looking for shelter in what was called the Neutral Ground. And the Neutral Ground is Westchester. Basically, the Brits have taken over Manhattan. The rebels are higher up in New York. Have you been to this area? I haven't been much north of the Bronx, really.
Oh, really? Yeah. I've been up there. I've driven through it like a ton. Mm. One of my roommates, Tosh, is from Westchester.
Oh.
So
it opens basically with Harper, George Washington, riding horse looking for shelter, and there's like a storm coming.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't stop at the first places he sees. Basically, they're not adequate for his needs. This is way too fast, too.
In which for the term of his confinement by the rain that already began to mix with the atmosphere in a thick mist, he might obtain such accommodations as his purposes required. Nothing, however, offered but the small and inconvenient tenements of the lower order of the inhabitants, with whom, in that immediate neighborhood, he did not think it either safe or politic to trust himself. the county of Westchester, after the British had obtained.
So basically, there's a lot of class stuff going on right from the start. Like, he's not going to stay with anybody who basically doesn't have slaves.
Right.
Like, if you don't have a house that, like, has some servants, and the Whartons, where he eventually ends up staying, they have Caesar, the slave, and I believe some white housekeepers. At least they have Caesar, the at least one black slave. And basically, yeah, he keeps going until he finds a house that can put him up.
I was looking for, like, some sort of sense of dramatic irony with the slave being named Caesar in the presence of a clandestine George Washington. And I don't know, maybe you did, but I was like, this isn't going to show up.
Well, actually, Cooper himself, the narrator at least, says that himself that the name might be ironic.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Maybe I was like, oh, okay, maybe it's signaling towards, like, something deeper, but it's like, no.
Well, what there isn't is any sign that, like, George Washington is a slave owner.
Yeah.
Right? Like, that's not really part of it.
Yeah, it's always interesting that they're, like, willing to defend it, especially in this time period, but are self-aware enough to know that it's, like, in contrary to like the more enlightened revolutionary principles.
Yeah, well, that's what's interesting about the argument between Wellmere and Sitgreaves. We can get to that later, but they actually have this argument about slavery and liberty and that sort of paradox, which is funny. Not funny, it's instructive that was noted immediately by the Brits, like, okay, you guys got your independence from us, but you have slaves.
Oh yeah.
And
what was it? I mean, it was one of, like, it was a unlisted measure for the Declaration of Independence, as they were inciting slave rebellions.
Right.
And Jefferson was emphatic that that be included, and the other writers, the other draftees, were like, whoa, let's not include slavery.
And that's really, I think, the one of the main failures of this book is with regards to Caesar. Is there's a couple times where he's cited as not knowing really, like, he's setting the table in one portion and he knows, like, the form of what he's supposed to be doing, but the narrator says he can't understand the underlying, like, sort of purposes of serving. And the truth of this time, if you want to have, like, a really good representation of what a slave would have been thinking, is they had a political consciousness at this time, and they knew that things probably would be better for them if the Brits won than if the Americans did.
Mm-hmm.
And that's nowhere to be found in this book. Do you have any comments on Caesar?
Yeah, I just, like, in general, I think Caesar is, like, indicative of this book has this very clandestine setting and this very, like, it's like a murky middle ground where things aren't clear and, like, even, like, morality isn't clear. But I never really see Cooper take up those themes in any way that would be, like, making the American founding myth more complicated. I think Caesar is just one good example of that.
Right.
Like, it has an appearance of complexity, but really underneath it, it's very clear.
Here's where, so Washington eventually finds the Whartons, shelter at the Whartons, and there's a storm there. Henry Wharton comes in disguise also because he's a Brit going into the neutral ground. So he gets there and he can't take his disguise off because there's a stranger there and he can't reveal himself. And so there's this sort of standoff where you have George Washington in disguise and Harper in disguise, and they're talking about politics. Anyway, here's where the sort of hints that Harper's identity come through.
The brow of Harper contracted and a deeper shade of melancholy crossed his features. His eye kindled with a transient beam of fire that spoke a latent source of deep feeling. The admiring gaze of the younger of the sisters had barely time to read its expression before it passed away, leaving in its room the acquired composure which marked the countenance of the stranger, and that impressive dignity which so conspicuously denotes the empire of reason.
So here's the two daughters. Let's talk about Frances and Sarah, where they start arguing in front of Harper, and that sort of embarrasses Wharton, the father, who's, I think, to use Kim Jong-un's terminology, would be a dotard.
Yeah, that works.
Like, he basically has his split allegiances. Like I said, his daughters, Frances is pro-American and Sarah is pro-Brit. And they start arguing here in front of Harper, and he gets a bit nervous. Because at this point, you have to understand, he doesn't know which way Harper goes.
The elder sister made one or two movements in her chair before she ventured to say, in a tone which partook in no small measure of triumph,
General Gates has been less fortunate with the Earl than with General Burgoyne. But General Gates is an Englishman, Sarah, cried the younger lady with quickness. Then, coloring to the eyes at her own boldness, she employed herself in tumbling over the contents of her workbasket, silently hoping the remark would be unnoticed. The traveler had turned his face from one sister to the other, as they had spoken in succession, and an almost imperceptible movement of the muscles of his mouth betrayed a new emotion, as he playfully inquired of the younger, May I venture to ask what inference you would draw from that fact? Frances blushed yet deeper at this direct appeal to her opinions upon a subject on which she had incautiously spoken in the presence of a stranger. But finding an answer necessary, after some little hesitation, and with a good deal of stammering in her manner, she replied, Only, sir, my sister and myself sometimes differ in our opinions of the prowess of the British. A smile of much meaning played on a face of infantile innocency as she concluded. On what particular points of their prowess do you differ? Continued Harper, meeting her look of animation with a smile of almost paternal softness. Sarah thinks the British are never beaten, while I do not put so much faith in their invincibility. The traveler listened to her with that pleased indulgence with which virtuous age loves to contemplate the ardor of youthful innocence. But making no reply, he turned to the fire, and continued for some time gazing on its embers in silence. Mr. Wharton had in vain endeavored to pierce the disguise of his guest's political feelings, but while there was nothing forbidding in his countenance, there was nothing communicative. On the contrary, it was strikingly reserved, and the master of the house arose in profound ignorance of what, in those days, was the most material point in the character of his guest, to lead the way into another room and to the supper table. Mr. Harper offered his hand to Sarah Wharton, and they entered the room together, while Frances followed, greatly at a loss to know whether she had not wounded the feelings of her father's inmate.
Okay, so yeah, like that's another thing with Fenimore Cooper is that with the women, at least especially in this story, aren't the most dynamic. They're basically confined to home, and when Frances occasionally, you know, leaves home, it's sort of, I guess, a surprise.
Their analysis of the situation is like almost without stakes, basically. And it's not in history. It's just these like two forces kind of going at each other, and that, well, we're with this side because my husband is this. So
yeah, it seems like almost sort of like a condescending.
Yeah. Well, it's like, why'd you add it, basically?
Yeah. Like, look, women can talk about this too, but then at the end, it's just, oh, well, obviously they're husbands are.
Yeah. I guess that it's like trying to illustrate that the revolution is affecting like every part of people's lives, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Even people who maybe can't articulate themselves very well or understand it very well, which in Cooper's mind would be women.
Yeah. You cannot determine the good guys based on what their political allegiance are in this story.
Right.
The important thing for Cooper or for this story is that you do your part honorably, whatever it is.
Yeah. Yeah, there's like a feeling of providence going on that it's like if you do your part right, like the higher-ups who are almost like demigods, George Washington in particular,
yeah,
will guide it the way it's supposed to go.
That's really, I mean, that's the main takeaway and my fundamental critique of this book is, so this is the first really popular book in America. There's some qualifiers to that, but in 1820, this guy in the Edinburgh Review, Reverend Sidney Smith, wrote this article that really pissed a lot of Americans off called Who Reads an American Book? And we'll play a bit of this later. But this spy is the first really popular book about an American subject that had like a sort of a broad appeal in the States. And it's about how you need to take the word for it from figures like Washington.
Yeah, exactly. It's very actively, or it's very self-aware in its like goal, which is to be table setting for like future American generations to understand how important the revolutionary generation were. Not necessarily because of like their political activities, what they thought, like, and where they came from, but because of literally who they are. Like, George Washington is important, and George Washington saved this country because he's George Washington.
Because he's this great,
yeah,
perfect man.
Yeah. And if you would have seen him like I did, and because he's like, isn't Cooper like one generation removed? His father was like a huge player.
Yeah, basically the story is John Jay gave Cooper a lot of the ideas for this, like in his dotage.
Yeah. So it's almost like, it's like transmission of vital information of like, you didn't get to see George Washington like I did, but I assure you he's someone who essentially was more than human.
Yeah.
And hence he made like a country that's better than normal. And this is why.
Right. And the frustrating thing is like, you don't get to see his secrets. Like Harvey Birch, the spy, is basically sentenced to live the rest of his days as expected of treason.
Yeah.
Because if it was revealed his true identity, a lot of important people would be in trouble.
Yeah.
But you don't know why.
Yeah.
And you're supposed to accept not knowing why.
Well, yeah, especially when he's like, doesn't Washington offer him some pittance of money? And he's like, no. I did this to be a patriot.
Yeah.
So he also like tarnished his name for free.
This is at the end when basically everything's been
right.
This is the denouement, as they say.
Yeah.
A second mild and courteous gesture motioned to a vacant chair, but the stranger refused it with a modest acknowledgement. Another pause followed and continued for some time. At length, the officer arose and, opening a desk that was laid upon the table near which he sat, took from it a small but apparently heavy bag. Harvey Birch, he said, turning to the stranger, the time has arrived when our connection must cease. Henceforth and forever we must be strangers. The peddler dropped the folds of the greatcoat that concealed his features and gazed for a moment earnestly at the face of the speaker. Then, dropping his head upon his bosom, he said meekly, "If it be your excellency's pleasure, it is necessary. Since I filled the station which I now hold, it has become my duty to know many men who, like yourself, have been my instruments in procuring intelligence. You have I trusted more than all. I early saw in you a regard to truth and principle that I am pleased to say has never deceived me. You alone know my secret agents in the city, and on your fidelity depend not only their fortunes but their lives." He paused, as if to reflect, in order that full justice might be done to the peddler, and then continued, "I believe you are one of the very few that I've employed who have acted faithfully to our cause, and while you have passed as a spy of the enemy, have never given intelligence that you were not permitted to divulge. To me, and to me only of all the world, you seem to have acted with a strong attachment to the liberties of America." During this address, Harvey gradually raised his head from his bosom until it reached the highest point of elevation. A faint tinge gathered in his cheeks, and as the officer concluded, it was diffused over his whole countenance in a deep glow, while he stood proudly swelling with his emotions, but with eyes that modestly sought the feet of the speaker.
Really landed on.
"It is now my duty to pay you for these services. Hitherto you have postponed receiving your reward, and the debt has become a heavy one. I wish not to undervalue your dangers. Here are 100 doubloons. You will remember the poverty of our country, and attribute to it the smallness of your pay." The peddler raised his eyes to the countenance of the speaker, but as the other held forth the money, he moved back as if refusing the bag. "It is not much for your services and risks, I acknowledge," continued the general, "but it is all that I have to offer. At the end of the campaign, it may be in my power to increase it. Does your excellency think that I've exposed my life and blasted my character for money? If not for money, what then? What has brought your excellency into the field? For what do you daily and hourly expose your precious life to battle and the halter? What is there about me to mourn when such men as you risk their all for our country? No, no, no. Not a dollar of your gold will I touch. Poor America has need of it all." The bag dropped from the hand of the officer and fell at the feet of the peddler, where it lay neglected during the remainder of the interview. The officer looked steadily at the face of his companion and continued, "There are many motives which might govern me that to you are unknown. Our situations are different. I am known as the leader of armies, but you must descend into the grave with the reputation of a foe to your native land. Remember that the veil which conceals your true character cannot be raised in years, perhaps never." Birch again lowered his face, but there was no yielding of the soul in the movement. "You will soon be old. The prime of your days is already past. What have you to subsist on?" "These," said the peddler, stretching forth his hands that were already embrowned with toil. "But those may fail you. Take enough to secure a support to your age. Remember your risks and cares. I have told you that the characters of men who are much esteemed in life depend on your secrecy. What pledge can I give them of your fidelity?" "Tell them," said Birch, advancing and unconsciously resting one foot on the bag, "tell them that I would not take the gold." The composed features of the officer relaxed into a smile of benevolence, and he grasped the hand of the peddler firmly. "Now, indeed, I know you. And although the same reasons which have hitherto compelled me to expose your valuable life will still exist and prevent my openly asserting your character, in private, I can always be your friend. Fail not to apply to me when in want or suffering, and so long as God giveth to me, so long will I freely share with a man who feels so nobly and acts so well. If sickness or want should ever assail you, and peace once more smile upon—"
Yeah, yeah, okay.
I mean, that to me, that was like the most, the passage that stuck out with me the most, the end, is this last dialogue mm-hmm. between there are really this oration that Washington's giving. And I feel like it's the scene that Cooper reveals his like intent as a writer the most clearly, even in like minute things. Like I feel like the whole rejecting the money thing is Cooper's way of being like, yeah, okay, well, you know, we were a delinquent country right away and didn't pay our veterans bills, and that which led to like Shay's rebellion. But you know what a real hero would have done? Just taken it and like sucked it up. It, right. it just seems like it's cool reading, because even though it's 1820, so it's a significant departure from these events, you can still see it, these events being treated with like a contemporary things that need a response right away.
Right. I mean, if a book came out now about like the Vietnam War, for instance, it's not the same distance in time, and you would still think of it as like sort of a contemporary response.
Vietnam's now is like, did we do the wrong thing? Yes. But did we mean to? I don't know. Maybe not.
Yeah. And I just think it is sort of like Harvey Birch's class is sort of, he's a peddler. He's basically, if he would have had a match, it would have been Katie, his housekeeper. There's sort of hints at that. Mm-hmm. Like she implies that, she gives him like a sort of a guilt trip, saying that like a man who can afford to take care of a woman should do it.
Right.
So I think, but he ultimately, his domestic narrative is sort of crushed based because like his father dies and then his house is burned down by Skinners. Skinners being the sort of like procure, like gangs that sort of rove, and they say they're on behalf of the Americans, you know, but they're basically just robbers and thieves. Yeah. And there's their counterparts are the cowboys on the British side. And apparently those are two real gangs.
I remember hearing about them, but not necessarily a whole, like Skinner as a term pops up right away. And it makes that kind of detail makes it much more realistic, because that would happen.
Yeah, I have a few different nonfiction books I want to play a couple of clips from that sort of that talk about this neutral ground territory. Actually,
interesting.
First one is called "The Unruly City: London, Paris."
Oh yeah,
London, Paris, and New York in the Age of Revolution. I'm not sure if I recommend this yet, but I'm working my way through it. There's some interesting parts in it. And it mentions our neutral ground here.
At the abandoned fort, a woman hauled down the rebel standard and hoisted up the British flag. New York would remain under British military occupation for more than 7 years. The occupation of the city by American forces had already left its mark. Now thousands of British and Hessian troops fanned out through the city. New Yorkers would feel the privations of war, the material shortages, and the psychological swings of hope and anxiety. The fighting was never far away. Continental forces made forays onto Staten Island. And after the French entry into the war in February 1778, the brief appearance of their ships off Sandy Hook in July threatened the city with a state of siege. If conditions were bad in British-occupied New York City, life was far worse for civilians in the 30-mile-wide neutral ground, the no-man's land in surrounding Long Island, Connecticut, Westchester County, and New Jersey, where the population hovered uneasily between the British forces immediately around New York City and rebel-held territory farther out. Both sides sent raiding parties to steal livestock and horses, to press men into service and ride down political opponents, visiting the full horrors of guerrilla warfare on the people. One group who braved the neutral ground, however, was enslaved African Americans. The British had been consistent in promising freedom to slaves in American-held areas who escaped and made their way to British-held territory, but not, pointedly, to the enslaved who were already within it, since the aim was to undermine the Patriot cause, not to alienate loyalist slaveholders.
Which is funny, given Caesar's condition there, right? So like the Brits were specifically, you know, fomenting slaves to come to like leave, but not if they were trying to keep the loyalists in New York.
Yeah.
So like the idea that Caesar would have been unaware of all this is just like offensive. But on the other hand, where this story doesn't fail, I think, is it does capture that dynamic rather well, right? Like the neutral ground.
Yeah. Yeah, the idea that you can't trust anyone.
Yeah.
Almost everyone is claiming to be something else, either for their own protection or to take advantage of you. And it's almost impossible to tell until it's too late. And often those two things are working at the same time. Like your own protection and taking advantage of one of someone is like the same act.
Right.
For most of these characters.
You know, it just occurred to me, and this didn't come up in any of the academic writing that I read, but Francis and Dunwoody and the sort of pre-engagement that they're sort of in is sort of a neutral ground of sorts.
Yeah, I think you could.
That leads to, it's the ambiguity that leads to her sort of fucking that up.
Yeah, that's interesting. It's interesting to see them, like, particularly the female characters having a central role in the thesis when they feel so apart from almost everything.
Mm.
Or like their own problems are exclusively their own and happen to be happening at the same time.
Right.
So tying it together like that would be interesting.
Yeah, I mean, like she, so basically Frances, there's a battle near the Wharton's house, and the Americans take over the sort of neutral ground that the Whartons are in. And a Colonel Singleton is injured, an American, and he's engaged, or he's the sister of a woman, is it Isabella? Yeah, Isabella Singleton. So he comes to recuperate at the Warden's house. Isabella, his sister, comes to visit, to help him recuperate. She has a history with Dunwoody, who Francis is sort of engaged to. She, Isabella Singleton, the sister that came to help her brother recuperate, has a unrequited love with Dunwoody. And Francis reads that as they have a history.
Mm-hmm.
Where Dunwoody wasn't into her, but Francis basically overreads the signals. And so Dunwoody, there's this dynamic where Dunwoody's going out and fighting these battles, and then he comes back and Francis is sort of getting upset with him because she thinks that he wants Isabel Singleton, who's sort of she's a more impressively spirited woman. And that, in fact, Dunwoody says he prefers the kind, gentle nature of Francis at one part to Isabel Singleton, who's a later shot. But here's some, did I play Alan Taylor? Here's some more from Alan Taylor on the sort of neutral ground. This is from American Revolutions, A Continental History, 1750 to 1804.
Some troops had the cover of official orders to strip a region of livestock and extra blankets to deny them to the enemy. Patriot and loyalist officers gave certificates promising eventual payment, but farmers could rarely collect, so they saw no difference between impressment and looting. A Patriot officer confessed, "Any army, even a friendly one, if any can be called so, are a dreadful scourge to any people. You cannot conceive what devastation and distress mark their steps." General Greene considered it impossible to carry on a war without oppressing the inhabitants. The greatest sufferers lived in contested neutral zones around British strongholds, particularly within 50 miles of New York City in eastern New Jersey, southern New York, and southeastern Connecticut. In those lawless zones, raiders from both sides and freelancing bandits looted the farmers. Reverend Timothy Dwight, a patriot chaplain, pitied the civilians of Westchester County, New York. Their furniture was extensively plundered or broken to pieces. The walls, floors, and windows were injured both by violence and decay, and were not repaired because they had not the means of repairing them, and because they were exposed to the repetition of the same injuries. Their cattle were gone, their fences were burnt, where they were capable of becoming fuel, and in many cases thrown down where they were not. Their fields were covered with a rank growth of weeds and wild grass. Robbers completed their ruin by torturing farmers to reveal hidden caches of money. The people of Westchester experienced the revolution as a disaster. Many farmers wished a pox on both sides. Dwight reported that the Westchester folk feared everybody who they saw and loved nobody. To every question they gave such an answer as would please the inquirer, or if they despaired of pleasing, such a one as would not provoke him. Fear, apparently, was the only passion by which they were animated. In harm's way, the people in contested zones learned to have no politics or to keep them better hidden than their money. Although both armies committed atrocities, British and Hessian misdeeds did more damage to their cause. Sniped at by militiamen who emerged from the civilian population, British soldiers soon despised and distrusted every American as, in the words of one officer, crafty, skulking, and assassinating.
I want to play a little bit of this this essay from Reverend Sidney Smith in the Edinburgh Review called Who Reads an American Book. This is from, I made an audiobook of this.
Such is the land of Jonathan, and thus has it been governed. In his honest endeavors to better his situation, and in his manly purpose of resisting injury and insult, we most cordially sympathize. We hope he will always continue to watch and suspect his government as he now does, remembering that it is the constant tendency of those entrusted with power to conceive that they enjoy it by their own merits, and for their own use, and not by delegation, and for the benefit of others. Thus far, we are the friends and admirers of Jonathan, but he must not grow vain and ambitious, or allow himself to be dazzled by that galaxy of epithet.
I'm not sure what he means by Jonathan here, but Jonathan basically means America.
Yeah, what is that?
By delegation, and for the benefit of others. Thus far, we are the friends and admirers of Jonathan, but he must not grow vain and ambitious, or allow himself to be dazzled by that galaxy of epithets by which his orators and newspaper scribblers endeavor to persuade their supporters that they are the greatest, the most refined, the most enlightened, and the most moral people upon earth. The effect of this is unspeakably ludicrous on this side of the Atlantic, and, even on the other, we should imagine, must be rather humiliating to the reasonable part of the population. The Americans are a brave, industrious, and acute people, but they have hitherto given no indications of genius, and made no approaches to the heroic, either in their morality or character. They are but a recent offset, indeed, from England, and should make it their chief boast, for many generations to come, that they are sprung from the same race with Bacon and Shakespeare and Newton. Considering their numbers, indeed, and the favorable circumstances in which they have been placed, they have yet done marvelously little to assert the honor of such a descent, or to show that their English blood has been exalted or refined by their republican training and institutions. Their Franklins and Washingtons, and all the other sages and heroes of their revolution, were born and bred subjects of the King of England, and not among the freest or most valued of his subjects, and, since the period of their separation, a far greater proportion of their statesmen and artists and political writers have been foreigners than ever occurred before in the history of any civilized and educated people. During the 30 or 40 years of their independence, they have done absolutely nothing for the sciences, for the arts, for literature, or even for the statesmanlike studies of politics or political economy. Confining ourselves to our own country, and to the period that has elapsed since they had an independent existence, we would ask, where are their Foxes, their Burkes, their Sheridans, their Wyndhams, their Homers, their Wilberforces, their Robertsons,
a lot of these have been forgotten,
Letters,
to be
Smiths,
fair.
Stuarts, Paleys, and Malthuses, their Scotts, Campbells, Byrons, Moores, or Crabbes, or their parallels to the 100 other names that have spread themselves over the world from our little island in the course of the last 30 years, and blessed or delighted mankind by their works, inventions, or examples. In so far as we know, there is no such parallel to be produced from the whole annals of the self-adulating race. In the four quarters of the globe, who reads an American book, or goes to an American play, or looks at an American picture or statue? What does the world yet owe to American physicians or surgeons? What new substances have their chemists discovered? Or what old ones have they analyzed? What new constellations have been discovered by the telescopes of Americans? What have they done in the mathematics? Who drinks out of American glasses? Or eats from American plates? Or wears American coats or gowns? Or sleeps in American blankets? Finally, under which of the old tyrannical governments of Europe is every sixth man a slave, whom his fellow creatures may buy and sell and torture? When these questions are fairly and favorably answered, their laudatory epithets may be allowed, but till that can be done, we would seriously advise them to keep clear of superlatives.
A big, big fan of the metaphysical take of the revolution. I mean, like, well, those were British subjects, so that's a British victory. Like, George Washington, like, you think he's great because he started your country? Well, he did it as an Englishman, so go fuck yourself.
Yeah, that is hilarious. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a pretty good takedown. It's too bad America in its 40 years of existence couldn't do 3,000 years worth of work.
Well, it's funny because there is a sort of paucity of novels, fiction written at the time. I mean, this was early in novel history anyway, sort of. You know, I mean, Jane Austen was really cooking in the decades prior to this.
Height of like mass publication, though.
Yeah.
The idea of just like writers churning out dozens of very thick volumes, like in the Enlightenment era would have been like the height of like readership of novels.
And it's also important to note the copyright differences. America didn't acknowledge copyright. It was basically just a free for all over here.
Well, also the shift of just in time of the novel, which was thought of as mainly a joke, like
that. Yes.
And particularly for women was shifting in this moment.
That was actually, so Fenimore Cooper's history of writing this novel, basically, he wrote one before this called Precaution, which the title, you can sort of place it in a Jane Austen type.
But. Or just imagine being like, I'd love to read that, a book called Precaution.
Well, yeah, it's like, but they're sort of like guides for young women to like how you avoid certain pitfalls in society.
Yeah.
I have a little bit from a historian, Alan Taylor. So I bought a book, The Pioneers by James Fenimore Cooper, and I looked at the introduction. It was written by Alan Taylor, who's a historian. I have three of his books. Eric Foner picked him to...
I know you've been talking him up a lot. It was like the one on American colonies.
Yeah.
It's on my Goodreads. They're a little long, so I'm holding off for right now.
Yeah, they are.
Is he older than Foner?
He's younger, okay. I think. So Eric Foner chose him to write the Norton American History series, and he's written American Colonies and American Revolutions, and also a history of the War of 1812. He also wrote a book on James Fenimore Cooper's dad, who founded Cooperstown.
William Cooper?
Yeah, William Cooperstown is what the book is called. And I haven't read it yet. I have it at home. But it's funny because I've been doing this like nonfiction work, and I'm to try to supplement this fiction stuff. And it turns out, oh, actually, one of those guys I'm reading has also written on this author.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is from Fenimore Cooper's America in History Today in 1996.
20th century readers know the American novelist James Fenimore Cooper as the author of the five leather stocking tales, including The Last of the Mohicans, set in the North American forest and prairie during the late 18th and early 19th centuries. These novels of frontier violence and adventure helped define the American experience and identity, especially for European readers. Although his narrative voice conveys a powerful self-assurance, James Fenimore Cooper, in fact, became a novelist during the early 1820s at the same time that his inherited estate in New York State collapsed under the weight of unpaid debts and court-ordered foreclosures. Despite a boyish love for reading novels and amusing tales, he did not begin to write fiction until he was 30, and only after the frustration of his ambitions as a gentleman farmer, frontier landlord, and mercantile investor. His father, Judge William Cooper, had become rich by founding, as a land speculation, the frontier village of Cooperstown in central New York State. In 1809, the judge died, leaving an apparently immense fortune to his widow and six children. But he had saddled the estate with debts that proved crushing during the economic depression of the late 1810s. Unable to cope with the financial crisis, James Fenimore Cooper fled from Cooperstown in 1917, taking refuge with his wife's wealthy and aristocratic family, the Delanceys of Westchester County, in the Hudson Valley. To his chagrin, they concluded that Cooper was a reckless spendthrift who would inevitably squander his wife's patrimony. Insulted, in late 1822, he angrily removed his family to a rented house on Broadway in New York City. Cooper might flee from the Delanceys, but he could not escape his debts. Acting on behalf of a creditor, in 1823 the New York City sheriff impounded and inventoried Cooper's household goods. However, the creditor decided to release the goods when his agent reported that they would fetch very little if auctioned. I have seen his household goods. They are of no very great value. They are few and of a cheap kind. This dismissive judgment must have infuriated Cooper, who took pride in his exquisite taste and so resented his ebbing fortunes. According to Susan Fenimore Cooper, her father began his first novel in response to a challenge from his wife. He always read a great deal, in a desultory way. Military works, travels, biographies, history, and novels. He frequently read aloud at that time to my mother, in the quiet evenings at Angevin. Of course the books were all English. A new novel had been brought from England in the last monthly packet. It was, I think, one of Mrs. Opie's, or one of that school. My mother was not well. She was lying on the sofa, and he was reading this newly imported novel to her. It must have been very trashy. After a chapter or two, he threw it aside, exclaiming, "I could write you a better book than that myself." Our mother laughed at the idea, as the height of absurdity, he who disliked writing even a letter, that he should write a book. He persisted in his declaration, however, and almost immediately wrote the first pages of a tale, not yet named, The Scene Laid in England, as a matter of course. The story is plausible, especially in Susan's claim that Cooper turned to fiction as a lark rather than as a...
Anyway, yeah, he writes Precaution. That's about a sort of British story in the mold of Jane Austen. I haven't read that. And then he writes The Spy.
Continuing with what I was saying earlier, what was most intriguing reading it was like as like a social document, watching these, what makes, like if you had to define what an American is or what America is about, you see right now in this book, it being like an active work on like certain people's parts to take ideas that would have been in like the consciousness of Thomas Jefferson in particular, that like the common man is and common sense are what can like rule the day, basically. Yeah. That if you can work the soil, you know what's right. And I think that guided certain kinds of more radical founding fathers. And now it's hard to tell how like that probably wasn't seeped into the consciousness that much of like what would be Americans or what even like the idea of American would be really open. But here in this book, you see an active work to take up that project and like democratize it in a real way.
You're right. Like, and I was a huge project at this time, I think maybe set off by this novel, is we're going to cover other books by Cooper and also by Catherine Maria Sedgwick and Lydia Maria Childs. And there's sort of like a book I'm reading, Strange Nation, Literary Nationalism and Cultural Conflict in the Age of Poe, by J. Gerald Kennedy talks about how that, like, America at 50 is sort of determining what it means, like, nationalism is, mm-hmm. and what republicanism meant and what liberty means and that sort of thing.
It's like the speed of, it's going through the motions that nations, or I guess empires and states, often went through, like early ideas of states, but just at a way quicker pace. Like if you look at like the Aeneid or something, it's like a way of describing in art Rome's like dominance, like why we're meant to rule and why we're like inherently good. But that happens like 400 years after Rome is founded, and it's like looking back and being like, this is great because we were always great. Whereas like the American project is like, yeah, we're gonna make our Aeneid within living memory of the events happening. And I feel like you can see the frustration in that review.
And you're almost able to just because of, you know, print technology and that sort of thing, right?
Yeah, it's like the national epic, but being infused with like the mass communication.
Okay, so this is when Colonel Wellmere, he's at the Wharton's house and he gets in an argument with Sitgreaves, the American doctor, about sort of the American Revolution and liberty. And he brings in that reference to slavery, which makes me think that this book might have, I think it was a borderline explicit response to that, the Sidney Smith mm-hmm. thing, who reads an American book. So it's funny that that is answered here in a way that I think we probably find less than satisfactory.
Now, sir, to you I triumphantly appeal, therefore, to know whether your detachment would not have been as effectually defeated if the men had all lost a right arm, for instance, as if they had all lost their heads.
Sitgreaves has sort of aesthetic objections to like using bayonets and things like that. Mm-hmm. It's sort of an interesting, almost critique of science and scientism.
That's interesting.
With Cooper's portrayal of him as like a sort of almost naive man of science.
The triumph of your appeal is somewhat hasty, sir, said Wellmere. Is the cause of liberty advanced a step by such injudicious harshness in the field, continued the surgeon, bent on the favorite principle of his life. I am yet to learn that the cause of liberty is in any manner advanced by the services of any gentleman in the rebel army, rejoined the colonel. Not liberty, good God, for what then are we contending? Slavery, sir. Yes, even slavery. You are putting the tyranny of a mob on the throne of a kind and lenient prince. Where is the consistency of your boasted liberty? Consistency, repeated the surgeon, looking about him a little wildly, at hearing such charges against a cause he had so long thought holy. Aye, sir, your consistency. Your Congress of Sages have published a manifesto wherein they have set forth the equality of political rights. 'Tis true, and it is done most ably. I say nothing of its ability, but if true, why not set your slaves at liberty? This argument, which is thought by most of the colonel's countrymen a triumphant answer to 1,000 eloquent facts, lost none of its weight by the manner in which it was uttered. Every American feels humbled at the necessity of vindicating his country from the apparent inconsistency and injustice of the laws alluded to. His feelings are much like those of an honorable man who is compelled to exonerate himself from a disgraceful charge, although he may know the accusation to be false.
Not though.
At the bottom, Sitgreaves had much good sense, and thus called upon, he took up the cudgel's argument in downright earnest. We deem it a liberty to have the deciding voice in the councils by which we are governed. We think it a hardship to be ruled by the king of a people who live at a distance of 3,000 miles, and who cannot, and who do not, feel a single political interest in common with ourselves. I say nothing of oppression. The child was of age, and was entitled to the privileges of majority. In such cases, there is but one tribunal to which to appeal for a nation's rights. It is power, and we now make the appeal.
So, yeah, basically, that's not a super adequate response to you, but you have slaves. What about your slaves? Like, we like to be governed locally? Like, yeah, yeah, but yeah. Your slaves, though. Okay.
Sounds pretty familiar.
And it ultimately, like, later in the story, Wellmere, who's arguing the British side of this, gets exposed as a bigamist. Just to show you what Cooper thought of his side of the argument.
Right, yeah, of course.
Like, that's a cheap way of...
A bit ad hominem much.
Yeah, exactly. Cooper goes ad hom on him.
Yeah.
So it's like, hey, yeah, that slave point, but you're a bigamist.
But it's curious, like, I'm reading this book on the Constitution right now, and by Gary Wills, called Inventing America, and he's talking a lot about the the passivity of the Enlightenment and Enlightenment thinkers, that like they are revolutionary, but only in the sense that they kind of see themselves, Jefferson in particular, as people who can recognize the motions of change, not necessarily into instigating change. So when they say, like, in the Declaration of Independence, when it says it's necessary because its time has come for America to become its own nation, not because it's the right thing to do necessarily, because that's irrelevant. Mm. And you can see that kind of argumentation used for the use of slavery. Like, it's not immoral because it's of necessity and it's in use, and it's not my place to put someone out of their place. Like the chain of being that Pope talks about. So it gets kind of, I feel like it can get kind of confused now when it's such almost romantic rhetoric, but you have to kind of remember that it's pre-romantic era.
This is where Katie and Caesar talk about politics. I think it's Katie and Caesar. We'll hear it. Katie reveals what she's heard of Harvey Birch's politics.
Ah, Miss Fanny, I'm fearful that no good can follow rebellion against the Lord's anointed. These events are certainly dreadful, returned Francis, and enough to sicken the stoutest heart. But what can be done, Katie? Gallant and independent men are unwilling to submit to oppression, and I'm fearful that such scenes are but too common in war. If I could but see anything to fight about, said Katie, renewing her walk as the young lady proceeded, I shouldn't mind it so much. 'Twas said the king wanted all the tea for his own family at one time, and then again that he meant the colonies should pay over to him all their earnings. Now this is matter enough to fight about, for I'm sure that no one, however he may be lord or king, has a right to the hard earnings of another. Then it was all contradicted, and some said Washington wanted to be king himself, so that between the two one doesn't know which to believe. Believe neither, for neither is true. I do not pretend to understand myself all the merits of this war, Katie, but to me it seems unnatural that a country like this should be ruled by another so distant as England. So I've heard Harvey say to his father that is dead and in his grave, returned Katie, approaching nearer to the young lady and lowering her voice. Many is the good time that I've listened to them talking when all the neighborhood was asleep. And such conversations, Miss Fanny, that you can have no idea on. Well, to say the truth, Harvey was a mystified body, and he was like the winds in the good book. No one could tell whence he came or whither he went. Frances glanced her eye at her companion with an apparent desire to hear more. There are rumors abroad relative to the character of Harvey, she said, that I should be sorry were true. 'Tis a disparagement, every word on it, cried Katie vehemently. Harvey had no more dealings with Beelzebub than you or I had.
So that's interesting, right? Like, again, we're sort of given a hint at this deep political, all these deep political machinations and conversations and dealings, but we aren't given any sort of insight into it. Like, Katie's heard them talking about it, and she's like, but they're saying the sort of things you could never imagine. But like, Cooper doesn't represent that for us, the reader.
Yeah, it is. There is an oddness to it, like that it would be as an artistic choice. Like, what exactly, what is like the sense of wholeness there? What is this adding to the novel, or what's your intent? I guess would be like a lesser way to say it, but I can't make heads or tails of it, especially when it seems like he shows himself quite clearly that it's not their place and it's not of interest really what they think, but yet it is there. I almost wonder if it's like an audience thing, like if novels are still meant for like women, it's like, well, got to put something in there for the ladies.
Well, no, I think it's more like we need to show that he was on the American side.
Mm.
But he's on it in like a, not because he, it's a sort of a very apolitical reason. Like we should just take care of that over here.
Yeah. Yeah.
The government,
yeah.
We should just do that over here. I mean, it's kind of a hassle for you guys even to be doing it.
And, well, you can't make a law from 3,000 miles away. That's ridiculous.
Yeah, exactly. It's very, I don't know. It's, we're always one remove in this story. It's a novel about George Washington's most trusted spy, and we're given no fucking details about like actual intrigue of matter. The plot that the spy actually it takes part in is to help a British or like a aristocrat, well maybe not, that's overstating it, but a British landowner's wealthy son who gets captured because he keeps stupidly going into the fucking neutral ground when there's battles on.
Yeah.
And the spy helps save his, you know, fail son ass. Like, that's not interesting. That's not, you know, and it's sort of just, and yet he insists, like, we can't reveal Harvey Birch's true identity because there's a lot of shit. Like, I want to know that shit.
Yeah.
That's where the story is to me.
Yeah. It's definitely a reversal of expectations of like a book about spies. It's almost always, well, the thing of intrigue would be the mission itself. But I think for Cooper, it's like a morality play. And the fact that this person is a spy and maintains his integrity, that's what is like interesting to read.
Yeah.
Rather than the actual fucking missions he goes on.
Yeah, exactly.
It's, which I think would be pretty interesting.
Yeah, I want to know, like, did like John Jay and George Washington conspire to like fuck somebody over in a very interesting way? Like,
yeah, yeah. He's like, we can't talk about what we did. It's like, the fuck? What
okay,
did you do?
Yeah, like, and it's sort of, and that's the thing, like, to be conspiratorial about it, like, to say, like, let's say all of fiction was this sort of creation, like, psyop. Let's make the population content with taking that for as enough. Like, I don't need to know really what this is, even though this is ostensibly a sort of democratic republic.
Right.
Like, the degree to which it's democratic is, you know, like, just do your duty, but leave the important stuff to, like, George Washington.
To these half-gods. I was going to ask you something. Did you read beyond that about, how, like, the social impact or, like, the popular impact of this book when it came out?
It was very popular. It sold a lot. Actually, his next book, The Pioneers, the first of the Leather Stocking Tales, really sold out of the jump, but never at total sales as The Spy did. So it was very popular. And every sort of, I've read in scholarship, like every sort of novel about the American Revolution subsequent basically was responding to this.
I was curious about, just reading some offhand things about it, that there was like a real interest in the popular imagination of who this spy was based on.
Enoch Crosby is somebody who said he was,
he made a living off of it.
Yeah.
And there's also numerous play adaptations of this, mm-hmm. which God, like,
yeah,
I cannot imagine how exhausting that play would yeah. be. But yeah, he made a living off of it or something like that. And then it was possibly found out later. But I was just interested in the fact that there seemed to be a real interest in like who this person is, which is, I can't tell if it's American or just a human thing of like really missing the author's message and being like reading that book and being like, yeah, who was that?
Yeah, exactly. And like, because it showed that he did some like parades and stuff with former revolutionary heroes. It's one that's interesting to show what a book can do for a sort of create a sort of neat a vacuum for a celebrity to fill.
Yeah.
Like Crosby, apparently, I haven't looked too much into his experience, but I guess he like was actually involved with espionage and stuff like that. But he definitely wasn't the Cooper didn't ever claim to know him or anything like that.
Yeah, he said he didn't get the identity from John Jay, right?
Right. Yep. Here's early in the story. Caesar, Harvey, Francis, and Sarah. I think they're intending to buy something, but anyway, Harvey says something that offends Caesar.
The younger sister resumed her seat, apparently examining the state of the clouds, while the peddler, finding a reply was expected, answered slowly, "There is some talk below about Tarleton having defeated General Sumter on the Tiger River." Captain Wharton now involuntarily thrust his head between the opening of the curtains into the room, and Frances, turning her ear in breathless silence, noticed the quiet eyes of Harper looking at the peddler over the book he was affecting to read, with an expression that denoted him to be a listener of no ordinary interest. "Indeed," cried the exulting Sarah. "Sumter? Sumter, who's he? I'll not buy even a pin until you tell me all the news," she continued, laughing and throwing down a muslin she had been examining. For a moment, the peddler hesitated. His eye glanced towards Harper, who was yet gazing at him with settled meaning, and the whole manner of Birch was altered. Approaching the fire, he took from his mouth a large allowance of the Virginia weed, and depositing it, with a superabundance of its juices, without mercy to Miss Peyton's shining andirons, he returned to his goods. "He lives somewhere among the niggers to the south," answered the peddler abruptly. "No more nigger than be yourself, Mr. Birch," interrupted Caesar tartly, dropping at the same time the covering of the goods in high displeasure. "Hush, Caesar, hush. Never mind it now," said Sarah Wharton soothingly, impatient to hear further. "A black man so good as white, Miss Sally," continued the offended negro, "so long as he behave himself." "And frequently he is much better," rejoined his mistress. "But Harvey, who is this Mr. Sumter?"
Like that as a sort of distillation of how Cooper goes apolitical and sort of, it's about manners.
Yeah.
And not, like, that's Caesar's political consciousness, whether Harvey uses the N-word, mm-hmm. not, like, who's trying to liberate slaves and what the different, like, victories could mean for him.
Well, it's kind of like you don't realize there's a pecking order if you're on top of the pecking order, that, like, if you aren't seriously interested in slavery or it's not affecting you, your livelihood or anything personally, then it is apolitical for you, that it's just something that exists. In the same way that, like, I feel a lot of people would be like, now children making your clothes in some foreign country isn't political. That's just something that exists.
Yeah. And it's interesting, like, the question of why Cooper includes this, that little thing. It shows that Harvey, who is not, he's not a gentleman.
Yeah.
He's an everyman sort of thing. But he has some sort of class blindnesses that Cooper's even showing are, like, obvious to, well, especially Caesar. And then it has Francis say to Caesar, like, oh, come on. Like, not now.
Yeah, yeah.
Like as if white people at this point are already sort of like over black people and slavery is still around.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
Like, okay, yeah, we get it. Yeah, yeah, we get it. You're mad about this, but yeah, we got important things to talk about right now.
But that's so relatable. That's exactly, I mean, that's like all political discourse
right
now, where it's like, okay, yeah, like, that's a problem, but, like, can we all just be on the same side right now? Because the bad guy right now is going to kill us.
Mm-hmm.
There's something interesting about the idea of the neutral zone, where you have to keep your politics hidden, either your politics hidden or the fact that your political position defines who you are, which, like, moving from, like, a colony to some sort of democratic republic, that was, like, the fear in Shakespeare plays when he goes to democracies to write his plays. Like, the big warning is that, like, if you become a democracy, or the problem with living in a democracy is that politics dominates the everyday person's life. Whereas if you're ruled by some sort of king or queen, that, like, well, everyone's on the same side. They dislike them, but they have to deal with it. So this idea of, like, this early forming republic, and inside of it is this, like, the neutral zone, which is supposed to be this area that British are controlled. But, like, the ironic thing is almost that, like, once the republic is created, like, the whole of the country becomes the neutral zone, in a sense of, like, everyone has to keep their politics, everyone's involved politically and has to be kind of clandestine about it. I don't know if that's a...
Well, I mean, I think that's the interesting thing about why this sort of nationalism in Fenimore Cooper's writing and in other novelists of this time and in literary figures generally, like the transcendentalists and stuff. It's post... War of 1812, which was important for sort of solidifying certain things about, you know, we're not Brit, the sort of American identity, like, that's when the Star Spangled Banner's written, things like that, and then it's following that they're able to start trying to piece that together, and, like, this, it's interesting, like, you see the seams, I think, a bit easier early on, maybe.
Yeah, or, like, the idea of the neutral zone being, like, a war is going on secretly or under wraps is almost kind of like a good way to describe living in, like, a democracy of, like, we're living everyday life and we all get along, but secretly we're enemies, basically.
Well, and it's funny because, like, this story, it's interesting how they have the Wharton's house, which sort of sets the action for the most part. And but eventually they have to leave that place. But this is at a time where, like, war is sort of, you take a break from war and just go home and, like, spend time with the family. And, like, I mean, of course that's sort of true-ish even now. There's R&R, but that a war could be being fought by, like, some troops on horseback, and, you know, maybe, I don't know how much is, like, 1,000 troops, how big these sorts of, you know, I have no idea, but. But it's close enough to where, you know, it's a day's ride to home.
Yeah.
And, like, it's how disruptive is that going to be to domestic life? And ultimately, Cooper shows, like, it destroys Harvey Birch's, like, house. And it completely wrecks the Whartons, too. The Locust, it's called. The Locusts.
Yeah. Bizarre name for a house.
Yeah. Yeah, it is, actually.
I mean, I guess I could... At first, I thought it was, like, locust, like, local, like, in Latin, but there's that T there. Like, it is named after the bug.
Yeah, and which, like, if you were looking for a subversive reading, like, maybe Cooper's trying to hide this as, like, like Americans were like this pestilential, like
a plague.
Yeah, a plague on America. But I don't think that's what Cooper is going for. Cooper was a Andrew Jackson supporter.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he's Andrew Jackson supporter that didn't trust the mob.
What the fuck is that? Like the Richard Spencer of his day. Like, I'm an intellectual.
We'll probably talk more about this when we do the pioneers, because that's all about like land, property ownership and stuff like that.
What a fucking annoying political position to take.
It's interesting. There's a lot of weird, like Poe was weird politically too. The Pioneers is a much better book. A lot more depth, to a lot more like, to a lot more sociological, like this is how a community develops sort of thing. I was actually surprised. Like, this is a very kind of a shallow book, wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, you can see the seams pretty clearly. It feels like a good author's early attempt. Like, you can see that pretty clearly, that someone who's not comfortable with the craft yet, and it's really telegraphing a lot of information to the reader, being like, this is what I mean when I do this. The kind of it's lacking the confidence of a serious writer in a way that, at least from what I can remember, Mohegan's was not. Was much more subtle.
Yeah, and it's surprising how fast he makes that turn, because this comes out in 1821.
Yeah, 2 years later.
Yeah, and he had another one. He also came out that same year with The Pilot, which is a early maritime novel. So he was a very prolific guy once he got going. Hung out with like Morse, some other people. Morse code guy.
Samuel Morse,
yeah.
What was your takeaway from reading it, or how'd you feel about it, like aesthetically?
I thought it was, you know, I'm more negative generally. There's a lot of that stuff, like that portion we played with him in Washington, where it's like, this is just the most amazing, you're the most amazing person with these immutable characteristics that is just going to carry the day and everyone sees it.
Yeah.
And you're just great.
Yeah. I wish there was a way to mass produce this meeting I'm having.
And it's like, and it's also like the Harvey Birch melodrama, like, you're so good, man. You are so perfect. You're always there for everybody that needs you. Everybody that's good on any side can rely on you. But Harvey, just nobody can like him though.
Yeah.
Everyone's gonna hate him, and it's just it seems childish to me.
Yeah,
it seems like it's hard for me to really put myself in this mindset, but like in junior high, and you're thinking of like cliques in school, and like everyone thinks this about me, but I'm gonna show you this, and like look at me, I'm this now.
There's a thing where it's like. You're all laughing at me because I'm different. I'm laughing at all of you because you're all the same.
Yeah, exactly. And there's one reading of Cooper where it's like he it was said in that Alan Taylor portion, his father was very wealthy, like a frontier leader, like founded a town, and Cooper lost that status. And so a lot of this can be read as like. There's these characters with the status that is just being waiting to be revealed as genteel and of that.
That's interesting that their mission is so important that it can't be easily like seen as heroic. Yeah. That's if there is any like autobiographical reading, you can definitely, or at least like impetus to be like, to shit like, or I guess it would be like Cooper having some sort of allegiance to a character like this.
Yeah, and it's also interesting to me that there's a weird condescension when he writes a character like Harvey Birch that's like not, that who's ultimately there to serve the like Washington class, right? Like he's there to do, we've sort of talked about this, but he's not there to make the decisions. He's there to facilitate for George Washington.
Yeah, but he's so obviously right.
George, yeah, exactly. And Harvey knows that.
Yeah.
And George Washington knows he knows that.
Yeah.
And that's what
counts. He's like reading it, that last interaction. He's like reading his soul to him. Yeah. He's like, I know that you're of good character. It's like, how the fuck do you know that?
Yeah, it's lame. That, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
If someone said that to me, I'd be like, what did you just say?
I guess we get a little bit of flavor in George Washington. Can go to William Hoagland's Autumn of the Black Snake. This is George Washington. I have this caption or bookmark titled George Washington Rolling Large After the 7 Years' War.
George Washington had come back astonishingly well from the humiliation at the Great Meadows in 1754. How he felt about starting a global conflagration wouldn't have been worth trying to guess. Denied by his mother a chance to sail away to Imperial War, he brought Imperial War to America. Denied a chance to see the big world across the ocean, he was opening, even making, what seemed a new world across the mountains. Certainly the outbreak of the 7 Years' War was the best thing that could have happened to his career. In the fast pace of that conflict, Washington quickly put events at the Great Meadows behind him. He officially succeeded his late brother as commander of the Virginia militia and served as the British General Braddock's right hand, the local on the ground. Few had a better personal knowledge of the West, and Washington showed his natural fearlessness in encounters with the Shawnee, handling himself with particular aplomb in aiding the chaotic retreat of Braddock's routed forces from the Monongahela Bank, where Braddock himself was killed. Good fortune led to better fortune. During the war, he married the rich widow, Martha Custis, adding mightily to his plantations. And now he owned the turnip field where he'd begun his surveying. After Lawrence's death, Mount Vernon passed first to Lawrence's widow, but when she died in 1761, it came to George. He'd already been managing it, and along with ceaseless buying and selling in Western land speculation, improving and adding to Mount Vernon and trying to make it pay would provide Washington with constant, lifelong purpose. He was elected to the House of Burgesses. By making his own investments in Western land, he was superseding the Ohio Company that he'd served as strapping errand boy. By his early 30s, George had surpassed...
Yeah. Well, so yeah, I think that basically does the spy. I do want to read some more Cooper just because he was such a read author at that time. Just to talk about a bit about this show's format, the plan is to do at least one of these a month, deep dive into a book like this, and possibly twice. The podcast is going to be bi-monthly, but if I can't do like a whole a book a month, depending on people's scheduling and stuff, we're going to also AJ, we'll call him now, and I, Chris.
Cut this later.
And if you want to be on this too, we're just going to talk about nonfiction. It's going to be Informationer.
Oh, cool.
Informationer is going to be the sort of off. It's going to be a more, not topical, but a quicker turnaround, a bit less research, but we just go play clips of a nonfiction book we think sort of should be added to the canon that people should be reading.
Yeah, sure. Whenever you need me.
But yeah, I mean, we started with this, and I'm trying to determine the chronology that we want to generally follow, because there are books written in America before the spy. There's like The Coquette and Charlotte Temple to around the turn of the century.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not going exclusively chronologically. And like, I also kind of want to go in chronology of setting. So I want to do less The Mohicans, which takes place earlier, Scarlet Letter, which takes place much earlier. Kara and I are going to do Scarlet Letter. You can be on that one too if you want. But that's the plan, is it's bi-monthly at the start, and at least one of those will be a sort of book podcast. So
that seems pretty cool. And then, so do you have like seasons then planned? Because there is like an end date then if you're doing it like chronologically like that.
Yeah, although I could see, the syllabus zooming, like more things being slotted in on that.
Yeah.
I mean, ultimately, if we're doing bi-monthly, you're not moving through books that fast.
True.
Like 12 books is not that many. I've got far more, and I'll post this for listeners who want to see the planned books we're going to get to. I have a lot more than 12. So the season... I'm not sure. I do think I want this show to go on for years, and doing American history, this is the focus so far, gives us the option of let's do British, let's do some French novels for a while, let's do world literature. I haven't really done much poetry research, stuff like that. There's a lot of room to grow in a lot of sort of areas to sprawl into. If we were definitely doing two books a month, then we're moving through. That's like 24 books a year. That's quite a lot.
And yeah.
Then you start gobbling up a lot of that history. I mean, it's going to be interesting because, we've had discussions about the canon and what constitutes a canon. And the real answer is people and institutions determine them.
Yeah. And then it's also, I feel like the great American novel has certain civic and political implications that the canon of great work necessarily doesn't always concern it with so explicitly.
Mm.
Like the great American novel always has to express some sort of either virtue or conundrum or problem that's central to every American's life. Like describing American life through allegory in a way that, I don't know, I'm trying to think of an example of some piece of art in the canon that doesn't do that.
Mm.
Like Byron doesn't really do that very well, but he'd be in the canon of great poets.
Yeah. Wait, he doesn't do what well?
He wouldn't be indicative of like what an Englishman is.
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
Or the English life.
Yeah, I mean, all these are what that should be, and there's sort of always a sort of disappointment because it's always fails, right? Like retroactively, almost. But like the fun thing is we can sort of create our own canon, basically. Like if this podcast, you know, gets traction, and all of a sudden, you know, I want to uncover a lot of books that actually are worth reading too. Like I don't know, I wouldn't necessarily recommend The Spy. Although I think it's just sociologically and politically interesting.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's what kept me going through it, was like, right, the implications of why this novel was written.
And that's really what this podcast is about. It's not looking for the novel that has the most beautiful sentences.
Yeah.
Like, we're talking about politics and history with this. But there are certain books, like I'm looking at here, I've been talking to Alex about The Quaker City by George Lippard. He's a socialist, did some secret society shit during the Civil War. Very interesting. I'd never heard this book, and I have an English degree. Another book, Clotel by William Wells Brown, which is the first novel written by an African-American in this country. It's also about Jefferson's black descendants. Which is just shocking. That's awesome. That didn't also come across my radar. We're going to expose people to a lot of books like that. And like sort of, there's a lot of these books were written by sort of reformist liberal types, and they fall short in certain ways, but some of them are radical in ways that you might be surprised. And, you know, a lot of famous writers are reactionary in ways that might surprise you.
I feel like novels in particular have like a special way of portraying how, not just the writer, but like a certain stream of consciousness at the time, both on purpose and then often by accident, like portraying things that they didn't necessarily, like biases that they didn't necessarily mean to show up. But, you know, you have so much room to sprawl and your prose is so long in like the format of a novel that things creep in there. I feel like it'd be a great snapshot for life at that time.
Yeah, and particularly when there's sort of constraints like in serializations, right? Like you have to fill up a certain number of pages.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's almost just like, it's almost like forcing people to, like a psychiatrist doing like force a stream of consciousness, like what's on your mind now?
Yeah, at a certain point it does just become a diary with character names.
Anyway, Alex, thank you very much for joining me.
Of course. It's cool. Last time we were, not the last time, but one of the last times we were recording was during the 1984 one, and I think we were musing on the political moment, and I think if I remember correctly, Hillary was pretty close to winning and Bernie was about to leave, and I think we're both like, oh, it's so cool that Bernie was there and that Hillary will be president, and like we'll just keep marching towards progress.
Yeah,
and now we're here. Is it 2 years ago?
It was about 2 years ago during the primary.
Yeah. Now we're recording on this massive rally for gun legislation. And it seems not like a totally different country, but my focus and interests are, and faith in certain things are completely like turned upside down.
Yeah, I think we'll probably release that. Maybe we'll just append this conversation to that when that comes out again, because the optimism in that and especially regarding the internet, and it's funny how much like sort of hacking became part of it, because a big part of it was how much, look at Bernie's resume getting just easily accessible for everybody.
That's what we were talking about, Hillary was like lying about like, oh, I didn't see you there. And then they're like, yeah, show then, the play the game tape, and like, you know, went off Twitter and like before the debate was over or something.
Yeah, and I remember thinking that even at that time, like, well, the forces of reaction have to do something about this. And I just, at that point, it wasn't clear that they would be able to. Like, I mean, there were times where I thought, like, could Trump win? Because I was really big into JFK conspiracies at that point. Like, I think there's a definite stream of on the right, an oligarchy or whatever you want to call it, that is willing to cross certain lines to make sure they get their way. And the weird thing about recording that podcast at that moment was I thought we had actually moved past that.
Yeah.
I thought, like, well, they forgot that they need to maintain this shit this way. Like, this doesn't happen on itself. Like Bobby Kennedy, MLK were shot 50 years ago this year.
Right.
And that shit did, like, imagine how different the world would be if both those guys were, like, maybe still alive, or like it just died like in the past decade. Like, it's crazy.
Yeah.
And I think both of them were killed by, you know, forces of reaction. And yeah, I don't know. It's crazy to be, it's a much different world.
Yeah, I think the idea of like faith in the process, like faith of like, yeah, we're like, it's pretty much like the track's already been laid, and we're moving in the right direction.
Yeah, now I think part of this, the difference in approaching these books as fiction for me now, is to kind of show those tracks where those tracks look like they had been set in a way that was going to maybe work out, or at least not throw us off a cliff.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's sort of like, let's go look at the tracks. Like, I thought about this whenever I have like sort of nuclear bomb anxiety. I think about like fucking, you know, 80s music, how that, and like what we think about Prince, for instance, changes if a nuclear bomb goes off.
That is true. Yeah,
tomorrow.
Yeah.
Like, and it's depressing to me that we have something that has that big of an effect on humanity, that it can just like wipe the slate clean or something like that. I don't know.
Or it completely like changes the context of things that are not necessarily interconnected.
And like, it's the delta between what is represented by a novelist in a work of fiction and what reality is at that time that is interesting to me. Like, do they point to realities that people hadn't considered or hadn't represented? Even if they do it clumsily or in a way that's politically problematic, is it there? And is it not, and if it's not there, why isn't it there? And that's really fascinating to me.
Yeah. Yeah, like seeing the hard work in making something obvious, what's obvious today, and seeing people who are like, it's going to make it my mission to make it obvious later. I mean, it's like without belaboring it too much, it's like he is the spy for like the American consciousness in that sense, where he's like, I'm going to make this part of your thinking without you even knowing anymore, or not even, you can't point to like, that's, we started thinking this way because of this book. His book's thesis is that it's always been this way since like the revolution.
That's not the real one.
That's a terrible, that's got to be it.
Well, that was the final minutes of the first edition.
The end of the beginning.
Of the Literary Hangover with the Spy. Much less glamorous spy than this one, this James Bond one, but equally sort of apolitical in a sort of problematic way. Until next time.